Director of Health, Dr. Geeta Prasadini, joining with us shortly. And also we have additional director, Dr. Vanishree, joint director, maternal health, Dr. Jayashree, and APVPP nodal officer, Dr. Sujata, with us to speak on importance of focusing on this prevention of avoidable cesarean sections and importance of this introduction of this serious ordering mechanism. So we also have a very distinguished expert speakers with us today from Tamil Nadu and from our state, Professor of OBG and HOD from RIMS Srikakulam. Dr. Ratna Kumar from Tamil Nadu, he is a maternal health expert and also working as an advisor for Tamil Nadu government in implementing various maternal health activities. So we welcome you, sir, for this workshop. And we also have a next expert speaker, Dr. Vani, Professor of OBG and HOD from RIMS Srikakulam, to talk about we as OBGs, what we can do to prevent avoidable C-sections in our respective facilities, and how important is it and how impactful it would be. So without much delay, now I would like to request our additional director of maternal and child health, Dr. Vanishree Madam, to give her inaugural remarks. Over to you, ma'am.
Good afternoon, all of you. And happy to be with you today on this occasion. And today is the meeting objective is, you might be knowing, but just it is my responsibility to say a few words about this meeting. And this is an important subject which is very alarming in the state, that is about the C-sections. And all of us have to think about this and to prepare a plan how to prevent the situation of this high cesarean section, and to make a plan of improving the maternal services by promoting the normal deliveries. And the second thing is, please remember, this is not mentioned to blame anybody or to point out anybody. This is only analysis of the present situation and what else have to be done in the future for the better services in the maternal side and also on the child health side also. And just we'll discuss about the merits and demerits and by the eminent professors today. And in the coming days, we will be giving you feedback on monthly basis, and we will be having the frequent meetings like this, and we'll have a good interaction with you people, and we can discuss all about your problems also, not only about the work, and we'll be with you, and we'll support you in all aspects, so not only in the program implementation, in all other aspects also. State will give you the support in all aspects to achieve our targets and the government's goals and this thing. So thank you again, and I'll hand over the mic to the next speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for that insightful remarks on prevailing situation in the state of Andhra Pradesh and your suggestions on providing regular feedback to the facilities on a regular basis. We appreciate your focus on this much needed initiative. So without much delay, before going to the session on how can we prevent avoidable cesarean sections, we will just have a look on a present cesarean section scenario in the state of Andhra Pradesh, especially in the public health facilities. Just give me a minute. Yeah, hope everyone can see this. Vikram, can you please confirm?
Yes, sir, it's visible, sir.
Thank you so much. So this is Nagendra Gowla, a state maternal health consultant from UNICEF. We are organizing this workshop in collaboration with Government of Andhra Pradesh. So we will just see for the next 10 minutes what is the present scenario with respect to cesarean sections. So we all know that the recently Government of India has given NFHS 5 results, in which our AP is standing in the second with respect to CSR rates in country, next to Telangana. So we are standing at a cesarean section rate of 42.4% of deliveries. We are conducting cesarean sections, whereas Telangana is conducting 60% of deliveries. If we see a public CS rate and private CS rate, we are doing 27% of deliveries as per NFHS 5 report, 27% of deliveries cesarean sections. And in private, it is 63%. So this is the NFHS 5 data. We are standing in the second in the in country. And if we talk about our records, reports which we have been collected in the year 2019 to 20, out of 3 lakh deliveries, we have conducted 31%. More than the NFHS 5 results, we have conducted cesarean sections. This is the state summary. If we want to see as per the type of facilities, on an average, all AH, MCH, PH are conducting almost 40% of their deliveries cesarean sections, whereas district hospitals are conducting 46% of their deliveries cesarean section. And in CHCs, it is 27% has been reported as cesarean sections. On average, it is coming to 31% of total deliveries in our state has been undergoing cesarean sections. So if we talk about the district wise comparison, in which with respect to cesarean section rates, percentages, we are seeing the top four districts, which are top five districts, which are doing more than 40% of cesarean section rates, are West Godavari, Krishna, and Srikakulam with more than 50%, and Guntur and Nellore 42% respectively. However, at the other end, there are facilities which there are districts which are conducting less than 30% of cesarean sections, which include Prakasham, Anantapur, and Chittoor. So this is how the present scenario in our public institutions district-wise. If we compare the same cesarean section percentages with respect to delivery volumes which they are conducting in the districts, we can see clearly from the slide that East Godavari, Kurnool, Visakhapatnam, and Chittoor are the districts which are doing a high delivery volume. Almost 30,000 deliveries we are conducting in these districts per district. And the interesting fact is those all four high delivery volume districts are at the other end of the cesarean section rates. So, for example, about Chittoor district is conducting highest number of deliveries in the state, almost 31,000 deliveries, and it is having the lowest cesarean section rate in the state. So definitely we can request them to speak about how they are following and what indications they are in for CS, and what indications they have been considering for normal delivery, and how are they handling the situations. So definitely there is something to discuss and learn from the districts like Chittoor and Anantapur as well. So if we compare Anantapur, the delivery volumes of around 20,000, the same 20,000 is being conducted at Krishna, Guntur. But if we see the same cesarean sections, it is very at higher side of 53% of deliveries CSR reported in Krishna and 42% of CSR reported in Guntur when compared with the same delivery volume amongst our districts. So it is clear that with increase in the higher delivery volume, definitely it is all need to be considered for keeping the CSR at an optimal level is also equally important. If we see the number of facilities district-wise which are conducting greater than 20%, 25% of cesarean section rates. In the state, we have 105 facilities. So it is interesting to note that among these 105 facilities, almost 72 facilities are from only 5 districts. East Godavari, West Godavari, Srikakulam, Guntur, and Krishna. So the northern coastal belt is clearly reporting, many facilities are reporting greater than 25%, and definitely this needs to be focused and given due diligence for further improvement. So if we talk about the teaching hospital scenario in all the districts, so clearly as we are seeing, the teaching hospitals are arranged from highest C-section to the lowest C-section. So again, the example from Chittoor, GMH Tirupati is conducting the highest number of deliveries of almost 12,000 deliveries per year, and keeping the cesarean section second lowest in the state. So it is 31%. And RIMS Ongole is conducting 3,000 deliveries. And if we compare the same with the RIMS Srikakulam, that is also conducting 3,000 deliveries per year. But see the difference in the cesarean section rates. RIMS Srikakulam is almost 50% conducting cesarean sections, whereas RIMS Ongole is conducting only 10% of cesarean sections. So if we compare the delivery volumes and the cesarean section, clearly we can assess the severity of the cesarean section rates amongst the teaching hospitals. So on average, 40% of the deliveries which are conducted in teaching hospitals are undergoing cesarean sections in our state. If we talk about district hospital scenario, there are extreme facilities which are conducting more than 50% of deliveries. Almost half of our district hospitals are conducting more than 50% of the deliveries cesarean section. So definitely this needs to be looked into, and how we can further reduce avoidable cesarean sections. Definitely this needs to have a look upon. So DH Machilipatnam is reporting highest cesarean section rate of 73% amongst the district hospitals, and the same load, more or less the same load, has been done by DH Chittoor and DH Anakapalli, and they are reporting the second and third lowest cesarean sections. So the indications what they are following and the way they are conducting deliveries, definitely we can ask the feedback from them and how they are doing. And DH Hindupur is conducting almost 3,000 deliveries per year with a lowest cesarean section rate of 24%. So MCH centers, it's more or less all are conducting at the level of 40%. DH MCH Vijayanagaram conducting 43%, MCH Adoni conducting 33%, and RIMS Ongole, MCH Ongole conducting 32% of deliveries cesarean sections. So this is with respect to MCH centers. And if we have a look about area hospitals, the cesarean section scenario, they are area hospitals which are conducting as high as 65% and as low as 12%, 15%. So for example, if you talk about area hospital Narsipatnam, it is conducting the highest number of deliveries in the state amongst the category of area hospitals, of almost 4,200 deliveries per year. But it is in the lowest quartile of cesarean section rates, of reporting around 27%. So definitely this suggests that deliveries, if we conduct a maximum number of deliveries, it is possible to keep the CSR rate low in our facilities, subjected to the conditions in our facilities. So there are almost 8 facilities which are doing more than 50% of deliveries are hospitals amongst the area hospital category. So amongst AH Tanuku being the highest, and Kavali with 64% of cesarean sections, and Thadepalli Gudam, Jangareddy Gudam, and Ramchandrapuram, which are conducting 63, 55, 57 almost percent of cesarean sections in their hospitals. So we have examples in our state only. Amongst the other districts, that they are doing the same delivery volume as the other area hospitals. Despite of that, they are reporting the less cesarean sections. If you see the area hospitals from Anantapur, Guntakal and Kadri are doing almost 1500 to 1600 deliveries per year, but despite of that, they are reporting only 17% 16% cesarean section rates. So this is one scenario with respect to area hospitals. And if we talk about community health centers, which are conducting CSR greater than 50% and greater than 25%, we have almost 61 CHCs which are conducting greater than 25% of cesarean sections. So among us, that the top 20 facilities are being displayed here. So it is clearly indicating that only from 2 to 3 districts, the top CHCs are conducting a very high cesarean sections. If we see amongst these top 20 CHCs which are conducting greater than 50%, only from West Godavari there are 8 CHCs which are conducting greater than 50%. Only from Srikakulam there are 7 CHCs which are conducting greater than 50% cesarean sections. And East Godavari, Krishna have 2 CHCs each which are conducting greater than 50%. So there is definitely need for us to look into the cesarean section rates of our facilities. And if we talk about the highest in our state amongst the CHCs, it is CHC Kotapomali from Srikakulam, which has conducted 90% of their deliveries at cesarean sections. So amongst the 200 deliveries they have conducted, 190 deliveries were cesarean sections. Only 10 in the complete financial year, only deliveries are conducted normal, and rest all of our cesarean sections. So in the high delivery volume CHCs like CHC Narsanapeta and CHC Kovur from West Godavari, they are doing almost 1600 to 1600 deliveries and reporting almost 70% of cesarean sections. Is definitely an area of concern for us, despite conducting many deliveries, having this high CSR is definitely something which we need to focus and look into. So presenting this background with respect to cesarean sections, what is WHO recommending? WHO has given a very detailed recommendations on non-clinical interventions to reduce unnecessary cesarean sections. Our expert, Professor Dr. Vani, would be speaking in detail about this. What are the advantages with respect to normal delivery? What are the long-term effects with heavy CSR? So we would be seeing in the next session. So to summarize these two recommendations, one is going for mandatory second opinion before going for elective and emergency cesarean section. And the second is implementing cesarean section audits and provision of timely feedback to all the healthcare professionals, which our additional director NCH has rightly mentioned. So these two are the recommendations which are strongly recommending by WHO with a high certainty evidence and high impact recommendations, these two. So only these two. In the next 1 hour, 1.5 hour, we will be talking in detail about these two recommendations. Thank you, everyone. Now I would like to request Dr. Vani ma'am to speak on how an obstetrician in the facility can reduce cesarean sections by preventing the avoidable cesarean sections. Over to you, Vani ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Nagendra.
Thank you.
So hope I'm audible.
Yes, you are clearly audible, ma'am. Please share the screen.
So hope my screen is also visible.
Yes, ma'am. Please, yeah. Please go.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everybody. In the next half an hour, I would like to share my views on the different aspects as to how to reduce preventable cesarean section. So the heading is very, very clear. It is preventable cesarean sections, how to prevent them. So this whole topic is based on the recommendations given by the World Health Organization on non-clinical interventions to reduce unnecessary cesarean section. So this document has been released by WHO in 2018. The alarming increased rates of cesarean sections was a concern to the World Health Organization since 2015 onwards. In 2015, the WHO has examined extensively and it has given a statement that cesarean section rates more than 10%, we think that it will reduce the maternal and newborn mortality and morbidity rates, but it is not so. Even in places where the cesarean section rates are more than 10%, there was no comparative reduction of maternal and newborn mortality rates. This is the first statement it has given. I would like all to mute their systems. All the participants, please mute yourself. So someone from CSC Denduluru, please mute. And the next important statement which was given by WHO was that cesarean section can cause significant and sometimes permanent complications or disability or even to the extent of mortality. So therefore, cesarean section ideally should be undertaken only when it is medically indicated. So these two were the important statements which were given by WHO after carefully and extensively examining the situation of the rising cesarean section rates globally. If you look into the factors which are associated with these high rates of cesarean sections, there are certain clinical factors, but equally important are certain non-clinical factors. So let us first look into what are these clinical factors. So these days, there's an increased prevalence of obesity. There's an increased prevalence of multiple pregnancy. There is an increased prevalence of the women getting pregnant at a later age and more number of artificial reproduction technology assisted pregnancies. So if these are the clinical factors which are leading to high cesarean birth rate, there are so many non-clinical factors also. So nowadays, women are increasingly wanting to have their deliveries at their choice. And there is a shift in generation because now women are working and they have to balance their work and family responsibilities. So there are certain physician factors also, which we'll be discussing later on. And from the physician side, also there's an increasing fear of medical litigation, along with certain organizational, economic, and social factors. So all together, it is very difficult to point out to one reason, but the reasons are complicated and they are interwoven. But anyhow, the sustained unprecedented rise in the cesarean section rates, we all have to accept that is a major public health concern. In the last presentation, I was surprised to see that one center is having 90% C-section rate. And therefore, it needs to be an urgent concern. There's a need for an urgent concern for some evidence, for some evidence-based guidance to address this alarming situation. For this, the WHO has been working for the past decade. It has brought out two important documents. So one document is on the clinical intervention as to how to reduce the rising C-section rates, and other one is the non-clinical interventions, how to reduce the unnecessary cesarean sections. So these two documents are given by WHO. These two are wonderful documents which can guide us to reduce the unnecessary cesarean sections. So with this background, if you look into the Indian context, the National Family Health Survey 4, it has observed that from the year 2004 and 5 to 2015 and 16, there was a remarkable shift in the rate of cesarean sections from 9 to 17%. And the same was endorsed by the National Family Health Survey 5. And this figure you have already seen, that out of the Indian states, the Telangana is top in the list, where there is 60.7% of C-section rate combined public and private sector. And next only ours, Andhra Pradesh, with 42.4% in total, and in private sector 63%, and government sector around 27%. Even this is alarming. Then you may ask, what if we do a cesarean section? So what if we do a cesarean section? So it may be the question in the number of minds of the participants. If we look here, so this table will say that the overall severe morbidity and mortality with vaginal delivery and C-section are not very different. But you observe the placental abnormalities. So suppose once a cesarean section, in the subsequent pregnancy, there is a more chance of the placenta to be in the lower uterine segment, and this placenta is likely to be adherent also. And if you look into the neonatal rates, outcomes, there's not much of a difference between vaginal delivery born neonates and cesarean delivery born neonates. So what are the implications of an unnecessary cesarean section? So while we agree that a C-section could be a life-saving procedure in a medically indicated cases, an unnecessary cesarean section can lead to an increased risk of morbidity to the mother. So what are these morbid conditions that might arise? So there are certain immediate risks which might be there pertaining to anesthesia in the form of shock, cardiac arrest, renal failure, or requirement for assisted ventilation. And cesarean sections are associated with a greater blood loss than a vaginal delivery, associated visceral injuries, especially if it is a repeat section, and more chance of amniotic fluid embolism versus a vaginal delivery in a C-section case. And the post-operative risk of infection, wound disruptions, intraperitoneal bleed that might require a reopening or a hysterectomy also, more chance of blood transfusion in a C-section delivered women, more chance of venous thromboembolism, and more chances of hematomas. So the risks in the subsequent pregnancy, as I mentioned earlier, in a post-cesarean pregnancy, there's a more chance of placenta previa and more chance of adherent placenta in the lower uterine segment. And always there's a chance of rupture of the uterine scar, and all post-cesarean pregnancies are ending up in a repeat cesarean sections. And remote risks are subacute intestinal obstruction, and these adhesions might be the cause of secondary infertility too. So these are the different outcomes of an unnecessary cesarean section. But there are certain benefits which are claimed. So if you go to an argument, there are certain benefits claimed for the mother. You can argue that it is relatively safe, cesarean section is relatively safe. it accommodates the concerns and wishes of the mother in the form of auspicious day, auspicious date or muhurtam. It avoids damage to the pelvic floor. From the fetal side, reduces the risk of neonatal mortality. And mainly from the physician side, that is obstetrician side, convenience. Convenience in the term of timing and duration of labor. So these are the arguments which are favoring the benefit of C-section versus vaginal and delivery, but these are all baseless and they are and they should be not to be included in the arguments. And the reasons for increased C-section rates, the fear of litigation, maternal request for C-sections, so this is going up these days, certain demographic factors, increasing maternal age, and smaller family size, everyone is anxious regarding the outcome, and privatization of obstetric care. So the reasons are very, very complex and interwoven. However, we need to have certain interventions to decrease the alarming increase in the C-section rates. C-section rates can be lowered without any adverse effects on maternal and neonatal outcome. The single most factor that will reduce this is the motivation from the obstetrician side. So physician motivation, I say it is the topmost important intervention to make a change to decrease the C-section rates. And the second most important is to implement a C-section audit mechanism. A C-section audit mechanism, and at the same time giving feedback provision to the healthcare facility. So these two are the two important interventions which we can do. And for the obstetrician, all obstetricians should be provided an evidence-based clinical practice guidelines regarding the indications of C-sections. And the second thing is an acuity-adjusted physician-specific C-section rate. We can see at which centers the section rates are higher, and we can address those problems independently and individually. And the other thing, for the private sector, supplementary fees for those who are performing more number of vaginal births after C-section, and second opinion for performing especially the primary C-sections in an elective indication form. So this is possible. And so there are certain reforms which we can make very easily. First is to standardize the indications for caesarean sections. Everyone can argue that all twin pregnancies have now become an indication for C-section. All preterm deliveries have become an indication for C-section. All growth retarded babies have become an indication for caesarean section. So these can be addressed. So these are not absolute indications. They are only relative indications, which each one of us can take a second opinion and concur with the indication to that particular women or not. The second important intervention which we can make is the increasing the vaginal birth after C-sections. For every post-caesarean pregnancy, they should be given a choice and should be offered and encouraged to have a VBAC, because it is safe both for the mother and the infant and avoids a major surgery. So this acceptance of VBAC by the patient needs to have proper counseling and patience from the obstetrician side. So these criteria regarding VBAC, so if it is only one caesarean section, if it is an adequate pelvis, a non-recurrent indication, availability of anesthesia round the clock, and with a provision of continuous electronic fetal monitoring, yes, you can offer VBAC. And if all the other factors are within the format, 80% there is a chance of vaginal birth in a post-caesarean pregnancy. The third important argument or request from the women is maternal request to perform a C-section for various reason, being at an auspicious day or a muhurtam, etc. So there is, so this point has to be taken into consideration, maternal request for C-section. It is not at all an indication for section. It is for the obstetrician to explore and discuss why the mother or the party is requesting a C-section and offer counseling and discuss the benefit of C-section and vaginal birth exclusively for these individuals. And then once the counseling is good, many women will be opting for vaginal delivery. So any clinician can decline a request for C-section, but should offer a referral for a second opinion. So this point has been mentioned in the WHO guidelines. The other important indication commonly done for a C-section is failure of the labor to progress normally. So this is very, very common indication written in the case sheets. But here also, if we adhere to certain rules, then this indications also can be limited, especially in the first stage. First stage, there is ample time of what is called as a latent phase. This latent phase has to be excluded from the concern of the failure to progress indication. So here, cervical dilatation of 6 centimeters should be considered as a practical threshold value for an active labor. So therefore, anything before 6 centimeters dilatation is considered. The other thing is, the booklet has given the definition of secondary arrest of labor in the first stage. It says that if it is a spontaneous labor, more than or equal to 6 centimeter dilatation with membrane rupture, one of the following should be there: 4 hours or more with adequate contraction and there's no progress in cervical dilatation, or 6 hours or more of inadequate contractions and no cervical change even after oxytocin administration. So that is the definition of arrest of labor in the first stage according to the guidelines. Then for the second stage of labor also, so there is no proper definition as to how much should be the duration of the second stage, but at least 2 hours in case of a multi and 3 hours in a primary. So these are the limits. We can have a watchful expectancy with the hope of a normal successful labor. And for all cases, now forceps and vacuum are becoming a vanishing art. An expert obstetrician can help us in an assisted vaginal delivery. So this option should not be forgotten in favor of a C-section. Then the other common indication which is written is failed induction of labor. So nowadays we see, so as a HOD and professor of OBG, so I see many indications as failed induction. So I observe to see that there are number of unnecessary induction of labors as well. So induction of labor before 41 weeks of gestation, yes, it should be done in indicated cases, but definitely seek a second opinion whenever you are resorting to induction of labor if it is before 41 weeks of gestation. And for 41 weeks and plus, yes, definitely it should be induced, but the definition of failed induction. So we keep oxytocin drip, which is unmonitored in majority of the times. Oxytocin to be administered at least 12 to 18 hours after membranes have ruptured before you claim it as an induction failure. So therefore, you need to resort to proper protocols. You need to adhere to proper protocols before claiming it as a failed induction of labor. And regarding the guidelines, the WHO has given certain important guidelines of induction of labor way back in 2012. And the Federation of Obstetrics and Gynecological Societies of India, it also gave certain guidelines in the year 2018. All of them are available over net, and each one of you can see these. Both of them are very wonderful guidelines, and which tell us that how much time you have to wait and what are the induction protocols. All these are excellently described in these two guidelines. Then there are certain selective interventions claimed by WHO, which are given in the booklet, that introduction of midwifery services. So this will ensure that there's a presence of continuous one-to-one support during labor and delivery. So this improves the patient satisfaction, and there will be definitely a significant reduction on the second important intervention is use of partograph in all labors. Use of partogram with a 4-hour action and 4-hour alert and action line should be used to monitor the progress of women. This will tell us where the labor is faulty and what to do in case if it is crossing the alert line. So use of a partogram will be highly beneficial, and to the consultant obstetrician should be involved in decision making for C-section. Please don't hesitate to ask for a second opinion when you are alone. And use of electronic fetal monitoring need not be done in all cases, can be restricted only to high-risk pregnancies. And for all fetal presentations which are mal presentations, please use the external cephalic version, at least offer it and try it. So then the C-section rates for mal presentations can be decreased. The other thing is regarding twin pregnancy. All twin pregnancies with a first twin vertex presentation, please allow for a vaginal delivery. And fetal heart rate monitoring, especially if it is an oligohydramnios or if it is a repetitive variable fetal decelerations, amnio infusion is one solution for this. And to summarize the four important intervention, first is external cephalic version for the mal presentation. Second is optimal use of partograph for all delivering women. The third is midwifery services. The fourth is one-to-one basis of care in a delivering woman. Then, so this slide, I put it to show you that more C-section in South India. For the reasons to be analyzed, there are more number of C-section in South India. And then the WHO has given certain recommendations. These are non-clinical interventions to reduce unnecessary C-section rates. The first one is health education for pregnant women, starting from antenatal care regarding childbirth and fear and pain, pharmacological intervention for pain relief, and other non-pharmacological relief methods, and counseling regarding the advantages of vaginal delivery, deep breathing exercises for stress-related issues, and certain psychological education for women to reduce the pain and fear of childbirth. So these are certain non-clinical interventions. At the facility level, for all facilities, evidence-based clinical practice guidelines should be given. So all these should be in a structured fashion, and a mandatory second opinion implementation of cesarean section audits. So monthly cesarean section audits and giving timely feedback for the facility. The other one is collaborative midwifery obstetrician model of care, which US, UK and other countries are using successfully. So therefore the C-section rates are less than 10%. And for private institution, equalizing the fees between vaginal birth and C-section. Maybe these interventions will reduce the C-section rates. And at the hospital level, the Robson's classification system. So WHO has proposed that each C-section you have to audit in the format of WHO proposed Robson's classification. So this is a global standard for assessing, monitoring, and comparing the C-section rates between the healthcare facilities. And this is already in a printed format given to us at all government. So in the case sheets, these Robson's criteria are there. Please fill up this, and then which will be useful for the C-section audits. And the other ways or recommendation to reduce the primary C-section rates. So once you have observed the Robson's criteria, the top four are for the primary C-sections. And it is our job to reduce the primary C-section rate. The prevention of first cesarean is a major drive to reduce the repeat sections. And there are numerous obstetric, fetal, maternal factors which are modifiable and which have an impact on the C delivery rates. And it is not an exaggeration to say that obstetricians should maintain adequate patience. Patience is necessary to allow a normal labor. And the recent data is showing that the labor course has now become longer. It is no longer 12 to 14 hours in a primary and 7 to 8 hours in multi. So those days are gone. Nowadays, the definitions have to be extended. The time is extended. And second opinion for decision, especially in a low-risk primary gravida, don't hesitate or don't feel shameful to ask for a second opinion from a senior obstetrician. The modifiable factors, that is labor dystocia, that is arrest, non-progress, malpositions, non-reassuring fetal hearts, failed induction, failure to progress. So these indications are surely modifiable. And nowadays, the other new indication has become nuchal cord or cordrone neck. So the sonologist gives cordrone neck, and the patient and obstetrician both are worried, and immediate they will do a C-section. And the other thing is cesarean section on maternal demand. So these also have to be reduced, can be reduced by ample counseling to the woman. Then the WHO finally has given a statement that cesarean sections are definitely effective in saving maternal and infant lives, but only when they are medically indicated. They should have a medically indicated reason to perform a C-section. And at population level, cesarean section rates higher than 10% are definitely not associated with reducing maternal and newborn mortality or morbidities. So therefore, it is the job of each of the obstetrician to put in every effort to provide C-section only in indicated cases, and not to say that I have done 70% section rate, 80%. It is not to achieve a specific rate. So all associations are now very, very keen. The American College of Obstetrician Gynecologists, they have formulated their own guidelines as to how to reduce the C-section rate. And the same factor is being addressed in many parts of our country. So this is another important work done in 2020. Then our association, the Federation of Obstetricians and Gynecologists of India, is also making good reviews of this alarming rise of cesarean section rates, basically focusing on the primary sections, our primary section overuse. So this, all these are being reviewed, and then WHO has given so many recommendations. FIGO means it's an international organization of the gynecologists, so it has given various recommendations. And to conclude, the cesarean section rates are doubled from the year 2000 to 2015. It has doubled from 2015 to 2020. Again, it has doubled or even more. C-sections in nullipara, that is the primary cesarean section rate, has become an important or a major contributor to the rising incidence. And majority of these indications are modifiable. So therefore, we need to focus or need to attend these modifiable indications for primary cesarean section. By asking a second opinion, maybe this can be addressed. And as per the guidelines given by either WHO or FIGO or FOCSI, cesarean section audits have to be done. And only by auditing and feedback, something can be done. And our efforts will be fruitful. The four important recommendations: first, educational intervention for women regarding the use, the importance of vaginal delivery, the benefits of vaginal delivery. clinical guidelines and second opinion, clinical guidelines, cesarean audit and giving proper and timely feedback, collaborative midwifery obstetrician model of care, and financial strategies that the normal delivery will be paid on par with the cesarean section in the terms of obstetrician fees. So these five important recommendations given by WHO might help us to reduce the alarming rise of cesarean section rates in our country. So thank you very much for your very patient listening. So thank you once again.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your wonderful and insightful presentation. And we appreciate all your efforts and time in taking out this wonderful message to all our participants who are OBG specialists across the state. You rightly have mentioned and given a due focus on the indications which have been important to be considered for cesarean section. And you also mentioned about midwifery and obstetrician model of care, collaborative care, which is definitely a very important intervention, which government of AP has already started working upon. And in that, as a process of implementation of midwifery, government of AP has been establishing two state midwifery training institutes, one at Tirupati and one at Guntur. So hopefully in the next 1.5 year or 2 years, we will be having our midwives in our state. So in a high delivery load facilities, we will be having midwifery and obstetrician collaborative care. So thank you for focusing on that intervention as well. And of course, definitely laying second suggestion and having a in detail audit, cesarean audits is also an important interventions which need to be highly focused. Thank you so much once again for your time and for your session on this. Thank you. So now we have Director of Health, Dr. Geeta ma'am with us. So thank you, ma'am, for joining us. So we request you for your address to participants. Over to you, ma'am.
Good afternoon. Am I audible, Nagendra?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Yes, good afternoon, all the participants. My sincere thanks on behalf of AP to Dr. Ratnakumar Garu and Vani Madam. Madam, just now I heard about your this thing. Very short and very brief, and then it's very this thing, Madam, self-explanation. Because all our colleagues are doing all the same practice, where we can reduce our C-section rate compared with the other southern states and neighboring state of Hyderabad also. The government of AP is planning to do the cesarean section audit also, Madam. As the Nagendra explained in the beginning, same type of load of deliveries in some of the area hospitals and the CHCs and the teaching hospitals, where we, when we did a comparison, how the same load will be delivered by vaginal delivery and by the oblique by the C-section. Here, one or two things, Madam, what really which enhance the everybody's. This is the motivation of the antenatal mother since her early pregnancy. That is the counseling, the health education regarding the advantages and disadvantages of the cesarean section. And the cesarean section can be avoidable. Some of the people there, still we are having the other painless labor also came nowadays. In the recent, so many hospitals, they are doing the painless delivery also by so many techniques. And in keeping all this in this, that vaginal birth after the cesarean section, that is also one of the important. Always when the first delivery is by cesarean section, the next is also be followed by cesarean section. That is also can be avoidable, Madam, because the first indication is this thing. So always, whenever a section is being done, in the, especially when we are thinking of primary, that it can be avoidable, or avoidable sections and non-avoidable sections. Some of the things what Madam said, whenever the, I am also being the gynecologist, I used to see the version, podalic version, cephalic. These are the things when we are in the undergraduate level and the post-graduation. Nowadays, nobody is trying this versions, Madam, in the antenatal period for the malpresentation. And the, some of the things where we can do is the apprehension of the patient and the number of pregnancies also nowadays, the young couple, they are planning only one or two children for their future career. For that reason also, they are thinking for one child, why should I have all this bearing with all the pains and all sorts of things during the vaginal delivery. Keeping all these things, now I request all my the participant and other colleagues of my same profession and other madams who are present in this auspicious meeting. Now we will have Dr. Ratna Kumar also from Tamil Nadu. Sir is a very good expert of this. You are welcome, sir. Then we will thank on behalf of the government of AP for your valuable time to be spared for us. And you also can be suggesters and give your valuable suggestion. How can our AP can progress well? And how can we reduce the number of cesarean section rate compared with the other states? And how my colleagues and other my participants, other my junior colleagues, they need your advices. How can we avoid the cesarean section drastically? And we, now we are asking so many colleagues of people are there joined from the medical colleges also. So I request one or the postgraduate also to can assign some good paper on this. How can this normal deliveries can be rated wise, because the population, whenever the highest delivery load will be in the big hospital. One junior most credit can ascertain this thing. Since C-section audit also, whenever we are taking up a section for that, at least they should fill up those audit forms and whether the section is mandatory or compulsory, whether it can be avoidable, they taking the fetal distress and the prolonged labor, keeping all the points in her view, and how can she progress? So, end of the session, all the participants, you can interact with our members and you also, because most of the times, whenever we want anything, any delivery means whether this is the outcome will be most mother and baby should be safe. That is main thing, and further to reduce. Thank you, Naji. May this duty address my senior colleague on behalf of AP and Commissioner of Family Welfare. I thank once again Dr. Vani Madam from Srikakulam and Dr. Ratna Kumar from the Tamil Nadu. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for all your insightful remarks and suggestions to all our participants across the state. Thank you. Thank you for your time and providing these remarks. So we also have Dr. Salima, who is a health specialist from UNICEF, who has helped us in bringing Dr. Ratna Kumar on board for, to give his session on Tamil Nadu's experience. So thank you, Dr. Salima, for joining with us. Now I would like to request Dr. Ratna Kumar, who is a maternal health expert and an advisor for Tamil Nadu government. We all know that Tamil Nadu, with respect to MMR, stands second in India, next to Kerala. So, and of course, this Tamil Nadu has lesser C-section rates in comparison with, of course, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. Tamil Nadu has been implementing the CS audit mechanism from quite some time with the guidance and suggestions from Dr. Ratna Kumar. So he is actively involved in various maternal health impactful interventions. So thank you, Dr. Ratna Kumar, sir, for joining us. So over to you, sir.
Good afternoon, and thank you, Dr. Nagendra, and thank you, Salima, for inviting me to be here. And my thanks to Director of Health also for her nice words. Could you share the screen, please?
Sorry, sir. Coming in.
Could you share the screen? Will it be possible?
Yes, but if we receive a PPT from your side, sir.
No, I have a PPT. I'll do it here. Give me a co-host.
Yeah, you are already a co-host, sir. Please.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Oh, yes, here. Is my screen visible? I think I must make it bigger.
Yes, it's visible, and please make it a full screen.
Full screen, how do I make it?
Sir, if you look at the icon at the lower right corner, sir. Lower right.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. Yes. Sir. I got it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, is it visible now?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay, fine. Of course, thanks to Dr. Vani, madam, who has done almost everything. She has made it very, very easy for me. So I just have to touch upon some of the things. These are all things which you had already known, that there is an increasing trend throughout the world, and it is not restricted only to Asian and American countries or Australia, but it is there throughout the country, throughout the world. And these are some of the countries which have got a very, very high cesarean section rate. You can take comfort from areas where it is more than 30% here, and all that. And whereas in India, it comes to about 7%. But we must remember one thing. This 7% is not the total Indian figure. As Dr. Vani Madam has shown, I think Nagendra has shown, there are places in our country, there are states in our country where the section rate is as low as 2-3%, 3%, 4%, and all that. And of course, the other end of the spectrum is places in the south, particularly in the south, Karnataka, Telangana, AP, and to some extent Tamil Nadu also. So though it is overall, we might be a little low in our cesarean section rate, we are not to take comfort from that. Then why this is happening? And what is to be done? Is it necessary to continue with the cesarean section rate? These are the questions which we asked ourselves in our state when we wanted to start the cesarean section audit. If you see the definition for audit, it is continuously looking at outcomes in a standardized way at the most senior level on a regular basis. Please realize that it should be done at the most senior level, and it should not be relegated to the junior most assistant professor or an associate who will be doing it. It will be more a formality rather than a real cesarean section. And the whole thing should be in a written document format report documenting the both the quantity and quality of care. We are not interested who is doing more sections or who is doing less sections. There is absolutely no place to say so-and-so is doing 30 cesareans in the duty, I am doing only 20 cesareans in the duty. No, that is not the purpose of the audit. And that is why we want the most senior level to do the audit, because they know where the importance lies, not at the personal level, but at the whole system level. These are the five WHO recommendations. If you look at the third recommendation, clinical guidelines, audit and feedback, evidence-based clinical practice guidelines, cesarean section, and timely feedback to healthcare professionals. That I would consider as more important than the first two things also, because you might be giving them the guidelines, you might be doing the audit, but if you don't tell them what is the real problem, what has to be done, then there is no purpose in doing all these audits and other things. So the feedback to healthcare professionals is also important to reduce cesarean birth. And the recommendation is evidence-based clinical practice guidelines, audit, and timely. Now, again going by the interventions, audits of indications for cesarean births and provision of feedback to physician nurses involved in the decision making for deliveries. Audits were conducted by a local audit committee comprising of 2 obstetrician gynecologists, 1 general practitioner and 1 nurse. This is from a study which I had taken. So they have included everybody. It is not only the obstetrician gynecologist who will do it, a general practitioner and 1 nurse. That is to make it more applicable, more universal, rather than making it as a restricted thing. We may have our own bias too, for something or against something, or for some purpose or against some purpose. But if you bring in a third party audit in that, then it is also removed. This, of course, you all know what is the C-section rate. Though NFHS 5 for Tamil Nadu has not yet come. So NFHS 4 is 28. I would say it was somewhere around 31%. And yes, these are the other things. It was Tamil Nadu was 36%. I would say that is about almost correct. That was the NFHS 4 data, 15-16. And there was an increase of 16% in Tamil Nadu's cesarean section rate, which is unacceptably high. That is, in a 10-year period, there has been an increase of 16% in Tamil Nadu's cesarean section rate. And this is what really made us think in terms of starting a cesarean section audit. So when we looked at all the data available, the Indian studies which we had done, the one thing that always that stuck me was everybody is using only the modified Robson's criteria. I have nothing against modified Robson's criteria. It is a very, very important thing. They had really done a great job in that. But the Robson's criteria, whether it is original or modified, whatever it is, the Robson's criteria tells you what are the conditions for which cesarean deliveries are being conducted in a particular institution. That's all it tells you. It tells you, yes, primary section is more, breech section is more, repeat section is more. It tells you which type of cesarean section is more in your particular facility. But unfortunately, it doesn't tell you why it is more, how it could have been reduced, and how to reduce it. That is what I noticed when I went through all the data that is available. So for this, we took up 3 medical college and 1 district hospital. This was a pilot study. This was based on modified Robson's criteria so that we could understand what was the cause of this high cesarean section rate. And in all the common thing about all these things is when the medical college, the one was high cesarean section center, the second was a middle level cesarean section center, and the third was a low level cesarean section center. And the district hospital, it almost reflected the average cesarean section rate. So here you can see, of course, everywhere the most common indication was a repeat cesarean section. So we thought we won't take it up right now. We will concentrate only on the primary section rate. So if you take the primary section rate, that was the second highest after the previous section. You can see in all the 4 centers, whether it is a high load section, whether it's a district hospital or it is a medical college hospital, the primary section rate was the highest in after that. Then, so we found out that the primary section was very high, failed induction in similar gestation, again in primary section at term, common indication was previous section, that could be brought down if primary sections are reduced. That is what we concluded after going through all this data. And we did analyze all the available audit forms in India and overseas also. It was a difficult task. And there was nothing which suits everybody. there is no one just for all. So we thought we would customize the cesarean section format and to our need and then do it. And there have been some instances in which in our state, some of the centers were doing cesarean section audit, but it was more of a formality rather than of real value. So we identified, we formulated the guidelines on which basis these audits to be done. I will come to this later. Yes, these are the basic components on which for conducting the cesarean section audit. It should be conducted for all primary sections. Then the individual facilities can audit repeat sections also, but the emphasis is only on primary audit. The audit should be conducted on a review daily basis, because you take it even once a week, you keep forgetting. I mean, everybody has got so many other things. We are not concentrating only on cesarean section. There are other problems for us. So we tend to forget what really happened on that day and all that. There is no point in saying this person forgot to tell me that, that person forgot to tell me that. So it should be done on a daily basis. I'll come to the question of daily basis, because that is one thing which was asked to me repeatedly when we had the four regional workshops for Lakshya. On all the four, this was discussed. I think Salima should be remembering those days also. The audit should be conducted by the HOD or the person in the next level, the second unit or whatever it is, because initially we thought we will take up only for the medical college hospital. Of course, later on, we included some of the district headquarters hospital where the cesarean section rates were high. And there, the CCS is the chief civil surgeon in obstetrics and gynecology. He or she is akin to the HOD of your medical college. Some of these hospitals also we took it up. And now actually we are doing it in all the district hospitals. So wherever they are, in case they are not available, both of them, the number one and number two and the CCS is not available, audit should never be postponed at any cost. The number three or number four should take it up and do the audit on a day-to-day basis. This was our very, very strict instruction to all the centers. As I said, it is not to find out who is doing more or who is doing less. It is to rationalize, and the person conducting the audit about the necessity for that cesarean section. When I show you the audit format, you will find out that column is also there. Then every fortnight, a meeting of all the obstetricians, including the postgraduates in medical college hospitals and in district hospitals, you have got the DNB course in obstetrics, wherever it is there, they should also be attending the audit, along with the anesthetist, the head of the nursing faculty, and also whoever else is required for that particular thing. Then a consolidated audit report has to be sent on a monthly basis. No, it's not last 3 months, it has to be changed. We started with 3 months, then we made it here on a monthly basis to the NHM office. These audit reports are to be sent by the 7th, and by the next week, we give back the feedback to them, the individual centers. And in case there is something which has to be shared, we anonymize the center and give the report so that all others also could see what is the real problem in a particular center. We will never use the name of the center or name of the person or any identifiable factor. This is the format on which they have to give their opinion on a monthly basis. Done during the, please, all 3 months, you make it as month. During the month of that primary section, absolutely essential is how much. More time could have been given before deciding for cesarean is how much. Most common indications and suggestion for reducing cesarean section on your faculty to the further lower level. Now, let me show you the cesarean section audit form. I hope it is visible. Is this visible?
Not really. We can only see your presentation, Dr. Ratnakumar.
Okay.
Maybe we can close the presentation and reshare the form.
Okay. I'll close the presentation. I can go back to that always.
Yes, sir.
Now?
Not really, sir.
Okay. Okay, fine. Then I'll tell you just the salient features of this. I really don't know.
Sir, a small suggestion.
Yeah.
You need to stop sharing and start again sharing. Then it will be visible.
No. You just tell me what I must do. I will do it.
We need to stop sharing first. Then you need to again share the document.
I have to close this document?
Yes. Stop sharing. Top end. You'll be having option to stop sharing.
Yeah.
Yeah. You please stop that and again share the same document, then it will be visible.
But there is nothing like stop sharing.
So if you close the document, I think it will automatically stop sharing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, I have closed.
Right, sir. Now we can just, we don't see anything. So now if you share the screen with the Word document, we'll be able to view the Word document.
Screen showing had failed to start, it says. I'll close. Or I will just go, I'll just go.
Sir, if you could just explain it to us, I think that
would help. I think that will be better. I'll just open my thing. Yes. Yes. We'll just see. Yes, now it has come. Let us see whether you can. Is it visible? Is it visible? No?
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Okay, fine. Yes, I'll increase the size also. So the name, hospital number, date, everything, maternal height, whether she is booked, unbooked, or booked elsewhere, estimated gestation based on LMP, previous stillbirths more than 24 weeks, mother transferred this is hospital with the baby in utero, if you have gestational age, preterm, mother corticosteroids were given. Now, this is the other thing. Who was the most senior obstetrician involved in the decision to perform the cesarean section audit? This is what Professor Vani was also insisting of getting a second opinion. Unless it is a life-threatening condition, the second opinion is definitely required. And there are few centers which, by insisting on the second opinion without any increase in morbidity or mortality, they were able to drastically reduce the cesarean section rate in their hospitals. So who were the people who were there to do it? Then these are just various indications for cesarean section. What is the... Yes. Whether it was a spontaneous onset or it was induced, what was the type of induction? This is because the second, rather the third, but we will leave the previous section aside. If you leave that, the second most common was the so-called failed induction. Yes, as it was said, the failed induction criteria were not properly followed. That is why we had a lot of failed induction. Now we have given them the criteria for considering it as failed induction also. So with that, that has also helped in bringing it down. So at that time, what was the reason for, what was the type of induction, whether it was a prostaglandin or it was oxytocin? Then role of partograph. I know everybody knows about the partograph, the way it is being done, but we did conduct a training for every staff nurse in all our PHCs, CHCs and sub-district hospital about over the last 10 days. And I don't know, probably by next one or few months, we might be able to get something. Then duration of first stage, second stage. Prior to the cesarean section, what was the cervical dilatation that was reached, whether it was in active phase or it was in the latent phase. Then multiple pregnancy, both babies were cesarean, both babies were delivered vaginally, or sorry, whether the first baby was delivered vaginally and the second baby by cesarean section. This was another problem for us. And probably because when they had their training as a resident, the second cesarean, the multiple cesarean for multiple pregnancy was more rampant than when we were all students. These obstetricians, when they were doing it, managing it on their own in the district or sub-district hospital, any small little indication, they took her up for a second delivery cesarean section, which should have delivered vaginally also. So that is another thing which we introduced. Prophylactic antibiotics given, estimated blood loss. These are for the primary section. In case it was a previous cesarean delivery, of course, I don't want to go into the detail, but these are the special care, whether she required, and that is for VBAC, whether forceps, live birth or stillbirth or vacuum, sex and all that, birth weight, Apgar score, these are common, of course. Admission, maternal outcome, maternal near miss, maternal death. What was the, if there is a maternal death, what was the admission, delivery, delivery, death, admission, death, and cause of death. Newborn outcome, neonatal death, delivery, death interval, and the cause of death. And this is what I said, opinion of the person conducting the audit for about the necessity for this cesarean section. This form has to be filled for every cesarean section that was done on the previous day. Probably that is one way of dissuading people from doing more cesarean sections. Then they will have to fill up more forms. So the person who is conducting the audit, the senior most, first to senior most and the next senior will be conducting, they have to give their opinion whether it is absolutely essential or more time could have been given before deciding for cesarean section. Take it from me, we really received honest opinion, because I'll show you in some of the presentations, some of the slides later, how in some institutions, the more time could have been given is really high. They were willing to give more time. They were more in favor of giving more time to this. These are all just the medical factors. So this is the basis on which we did the cesarean section. Let me go back to the, I think the PowerPoint is not there. Yes, I will reduce it and start again. I suppose it is visible.
Yes, so, sir.
Yeah, this is the cesarean section audit form. The Government of India has taken it up on a very serious note, and there was a committee. We had a committee. We sometime in February, that is just before the lockdown for COVID. So about nearly 10 or 12 of us have shared our views on various aspects of cesarean section. It is all being processed, and I hope sometime in the near future, the Government of India guidelines on cesarean section and also on cesarean deliveries will be available. Now, this is not the current one. This is, as I said, this is a little older one. So that is why, but you can take, see, at one end of the spectrum, we had an institution where the cesarean section rate was as high as 68%. And at the other end, we had an institution where it was as low as 43%. Now, after we started doing the cesarean section rate, there is a drastic reduction in all these things. You can see, and this is the institution which I said, the Trichy, the second one, second from last, yes. This is the institution which I said, where by, insisting on a second opinion from a senior person for all primary sections, they were able to bring it down to a very, very low level. And of course, there are certain institutions where we could not make much of a dent. See, these are all some of the institution one and here. This at least, there was a appreciable reduction in that. But there are some institutions like here, here and all that, not much of an impact we could make out. And this you can see again, how the cesarean section, the number of primary section has been slowly coming down. And we sent it for the best practices this time. But at that time, what we have found out is our cesarean section rate in both medical colleges and district hospitals together, now we have included all the 32 district hospitals also, is as low as 20%. Of course, our little high is because of the district hospital. There are some real practical difficulties in the district hospitals where the primary section rate appears to be high. And this is what I said, where more time could have been given. See, they found out that 18.5% of cesarean sections could have been, more time could have been given. Then 17.1. These are all not our opinion. This is the opinion which the people from those medical colleges have given. And these are the district hospital figures. Now look at this. Here, there is a difference. There is a difference, but I am not very much happy with the district hospital figures. There are some practical difficulties. I know that I have, I can understand, and that is being addressed now also, mainly due to the shortage of anesthetist, whenever there is an anesthetist, they try to finish off the cesarean rather than getting it. But now we will be able to reduce this level also. So these are all the equipment, these are all the outcome of our cesarean section rate. We are continuing it for the second year now. We have started more than 2 years since we started. We started from August 18th. So it is nearly 2.5 years. And this year, I mean, we always have it from April to March. So by March, we are hoping for a reduction in cesarean section, primary section, particularly the primary section, to somewhere around 16 to 17% of our cesarean section rate. Even in our district hospitals, you can see that nearly 34% in this particular district, they found out that more time could have been given and cesarean sections have been done in a hurried fashion. And all these things have been shared with them. Every month we share it within a week of getting it from them. And so they realize what it is. And then we keep following it, what is happening. By this March, we intend to finish the 2021 data. And we intend to publish all our experience over the 3 years. And we do hope that next time when I present it in some other forum, I'll be able to give you a better picture on that. So what we could conclude with this presentation, this outcome, the outcome here is there is a definite cesarean section rate, decline in cesarean section rate, particularly when the cesarean section is being done. This to a great extent depends on the motivation of the person who is doing the cesarean section. If that person, whether it is the HOD or number two or number three, whoever it is, if that person is not motivated to do the cesarean section audit, the outcome is not good. we did have this problem to begin with, but now the problem is not there anymore. There are one or two, you just can't avoid that. I can tell you with that, all these years of experience, I can tell you. And I know, I hope a senior person like Professor Vani will agree with me that some people you just cannot see. But overall, there has been a definite decrease in primary section rate. And indirectly, it is reducing the incidence of cesarean section rate also. Then we have given them the opportunity to identify what is the problem in the individual facilities. So very often now, they come back to us and then say, this is our problem. That is why it is there. So we want to, we are going to do all these things for reducing the thing. That much of a thing. This is a little older presentation. So from 55, we have brought it down to 23. I hope by this financial year end, we will have something like 16 to 18% of primary section rate. Once again, my thanks to UNICEF, Salima, Nagendra, and the Director of Health Services in Andhra Pradesh for permitting me to share my views. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir, for your wonderful session on Tamil Nadu's experience on implementing the CS audit mechanism. You rightly shared all your experiences in the past 2 years being a second state of with respect to MMR, top second state implementing this whole intervention within such large number of facilities. Definitely requires a lot of dedication and continuous monitoring. Thank you sharing for that. And the analysis you have showed has rightly, given that the cesarean section has been reduced in all the facilities which you have implemented this CS audit. Thank you for introducing all the checklists which need to be done while implementing this CS audit, and also the monthly report which is expected from the facility to the district and the states. So in the recent review meeting by the CHFW-AP, it has been decided that this cesarean section audit will be initiated, implemented in all high delivery load facilities, which means like all the area hospital and above level facilities, and also in the CHCs which are conducting high cesarean sections. So thank you so much for sharing all your experience and insights, which will definitely much more beneficial for all the participants, OBG specialists who have joined here today. Thank you so much, sir, once again. So now I would like to request Dr. Sujata, who is a nodal officer from APVBP, to give her remarks and instructions to all the facilities with respect to CS audit mechanism. Over to you, ma'am.
Hello, good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for the elaborate, detailed discussion on the increasing alarming rates of cesarean section. And I would like to say a few words about this cesarean increase in the cesarean section.
Madam,
hello. Please mute your phones, madam. Hello.
Yeah, sorry for that, ma'am. Please continue.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Madam, Dr. Vani Sri, Professor Vani, Dr. Vani, Professor HOD, GMC, Srikakulam, for the elaborate discussion and the suggestions given by Madam. Please, all the superintendents, HODs, and obstetricians to follow the suggestions given by Dr. Professor Madam Vani and Dr. Ratnakumar, a health expert and advisor from Tamil Nadu, and please make a note of their experiences and their suggestions and follow Lizabeth. And I would like to address these districts about the high cesarean section rate in Srikakulam, East Godavari, West Godavari, and Krishna districts. And the DCHS are directed to observe the high cesarean section rates and conduct cesarean section audits and send the reports to the state office to review the cesarean section rates. It is very high, and in some of the districts it is as high as 60 to 70%. Please make a note and see that every step is taken to take the to reduce the cesarean section rates. It is very elaborately explained how to prevent cesarean sections, how to preventable cesarean sections can be reduced, and the take home message is think twice before you do cesarean section. Be patient and take time and be patient in delivering the babies and reduce the cesarean sections. All especially the CHC Kotabommali area hospital Narsannapeta and some of the hospitals in West Godavari, Krishna, doing very high number of cesarean sections, and we stood second in all over India for not a good reason, but for the high cesarean section rate. The formats are communicated already to you in how to conduct the cesarean sections audit and how to fill up the forms. You go through those forms and everything is self-explainable, and send it timely so that we can reduce the cesarean section rate. Thank you for the elaborate and eye-opening session of this evening, Dr. Nagendra and Dr. Jayashree Madam, for giving me the opportunity and explain the necessity for the reduction in the cesarean section rate. Thank you very much. Over to Dr. Nagendra.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for all the detailed instructions. Thank you. And thank you for being there and implementing various
Dr. Nagendra, please explain once about this showing these formats to all the online. Okay.
Sure. Definitely, ma'am. Shortly, we will be sending orders from CHFW. Also, mentioning various different instructions and which formats need to be filled. And it has been decided that initially we will be only doing audits for primary cesarean sections in our hospitals. So in the later stages, once we completely doing the primary cesareans audits and monthly reports sending to the districts and state, then we will be forwarding with a repeated CS also. So to start with, we will be starting audits for only primary C-sections done at our facilities. So we would like to thank Dr. Sujata ma'am also for her support in implementing various maternal health interventions, especially in APVPP facilities. So thank you all participants for your active participation and active listening if any one of you have any doubts or into any discuss with speakers, please raise hand and we can have the discussion. So meanwhile, we will be seeing the formats for next few minutes. Hope everyone can see now. Actually, this format has been already been displayed by Dr. Ratnakumar sir, where this audit form should be filled for every primary C-section done at our respective facilities. So, which talks about obstetric history and details of that cesarean section which has done in our facility. What is the indication? And was it induced or spontaneous? Whether did we use pre-labor prostaglandin, oxytocin for induction, and was partograph plotted? And were the membranes ruptured prior to the cesarean section? And whether it is an emergency or elective C-section, first stage duration in the second stage duration in the... So it has a details about of all the cesarean section, of the cesarean section which is done. And it also requests the data of previous cesarean section. If we are filling it for repeated CS, we need to fill this information of the previous cesarean section also. So, and the fetal outcomes, the baby sex, birth weight, upper score, whether transfer has been done to SNCU, NICU, what is the maternal outcome, what is the neonatal outcome, and what is the opinion of the person conducting the audit about the necessity of this cesarean section? Once primary C-section done in our hospital, this audit form need to be filled. For suppose we are doing 50 cesarean sections in our hospital per month. Among 50, 20 are primary C-sections. So we should have this 20 audit forms for 20 primary C-sections. In this opinion, for each primary C-section need to be given by the senior most obstetrician in that facility, whether the opinion is like absolutely essential at that time or more time could have been given before deciding the C-sections. So this is the audit form. This we would be we have sent already to all the medical superintendents of the hospitals, but along with the order we also again attach this order. And also we have a monthly report which is a summary of all these audit forms. Yeah. I'm sorry. Yeah. So this monthly format, monthly reporting format is very simple. It talks about how many deliveries we have conducted in that month and how many cesarean sections out of total deliveries, and out of cesarean sections, how many are primary CS, and the summary of the last item which we have seen in the audit form, opinion. So among those cesarean sections, out of how many which the opinion was absolutely essential at that time, and the opinion of more time could have been given for deciding the CS. This we have seen in the Dr. Ratnakumar's presentation also, that the opinion has come for each and every cesarean section, and further on quarterly analysis, we will discuss with all of the facilities regarding the outcome of these monthly reports analysis. And for every month, we need to give top three indications for cesarean sections. So the three most common indications for conducting cesarean sections we need to give, and we can always include a suggestions for further reduction of cesarean sections in the facility. So this is the monthly reporting format which will be attached to the order which you'll be receiving soon. So thank you everyone, each and every participant for joining us. I would like to express my sincere thanks to Director of Health, Dr. Geeta Ma'am, for her continuous support and maternal health, Dr. Vanishree ma'am, and joint director of maternal health, Dr. Jayashree ma'am, for continuously supporting and implementing so many maternal health programs in our state, and also Dr. Sujata ma'am, who is an old officer from ABVBP, for being there continuously to implement various maternal health interventions. Thank you, everyone. The closing remarks from our additional director, ma'am.
Once again, I thank all the participants of today's program, Dr. Vani Madam, the Professor of Obstetrics and Gynecology from RIMS Hospital, and Dr. Ratna Kumar from the Chennai, for giving their excellent presentations and their experiences, which are very helpful to the state of Andhra Pradesh in achieving this target and this program today. And I also thank the Director of Health, Madam, for giving her valuable experiences, and the participants of gynecologists and the other doctors who are participated from all 13 districts of Andhra Pradesh. Thank you very much for your participation. Hope our state will achieve our targets and whatever we are planning for the improvement of the maternal health and the child health in the coming days. Thank you. Thank you, one and all. Sorry, I also thank the UNICEF organization for giving their valuable support and organizing these sessions. And I profusely thank Dr. Sanjeev Upadhyaya and his team of doctors in this program. Thank you. Thank you once again.
Thank you, ma'am, for that generous comment. So we will be closing this session now. Please get registered in the link which you have been given in the chat box, so that we can share all the PPTs of today's session. Thank you so much.
Dr. Nagendra Garu.
Yes, ma'am, please.
Dr. Garu, like active labor, like previously during the Dakshata trainings and all, it was taken as 4 centimeters, no? Like ma'am was telling in the presentation, 6 centimeters as active labor. Is it so now?
Sorry, ma'am, can you please repeat?
Like part of, in the partograph, active labor would be 4, like in Dakshata and all, we learned it was 4 centimeters. Tani Vani ma'am, 6 centimeters and naru, like it changed to 6 centimeters also.
Thank you for raising that concern. May we request Dr. Vani ma'am to respond to this? Anyhow, she has mentioned that this is an updated guideline, which has recommended from WHO. Oh. But anyhow, we will see Dr. Vani ma'am is around so that she can respond directly.
Oh, okay. Thank you, doctor.
Sir, good evening, Dr. Nagendra garu.
Sir, 1 minute. Ma'am, I think that was the response, but I will come back to you after discussion with Dr. Vani ma'am. Okay.
Oh, thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Sir, please, you're saying something.
Sir, I am a senior gynecologist working at Community Health Center, Sompeta.
Sir.
Sir, in the rural community health center setup, because of lack of some anesthetic facilities around the clock facility, is there, and monitoring of the patients with the minimal staff nurses, a little bit difficult task. So that this is also participating some increasing number of cases. And another thing is, by the good work by the Andhra Pradesh government, they are supplying ultrasound machines so that we can be able to identify a relatively large number of oligohydramnias and abnormal presentations also, so that also in the rural setup there is a little bit increase in cesarean sections, sir.
Okay, thank you for your observation, sir. Your observations are duly considered.
Sir, thank you for the feedback. This meeting is to